You will send to you the contract of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father. You are seen for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us and forgive us of our sins and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory, glory to God, glory.
Let us pray. Grant we pray, O my God, that always under the speech of things, to make her out in both ways of it, that which is pleasing to you. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Leviticus. The Lord spoke to Moses. He said, "Speak to the whole community of the sons of Israel, and say to them, 'Be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy. You must not bear hatred for your brother in your heart. You must openly tell him, your neighbor, of his offense. This way you will not take a sin upon yourself. You must not exact vengeance, nor must you bear a grudge against the children of your people. You must love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord is kind and merciful. first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians, did you realize that you are God's temple and that the Spirit of God was living among you? If anybody should destroy the temple of God, God will destroy him, because the temple of God is sacred and you are that temple. Make no mistake about it. If any one of you think of himself as wise in the ordinary sense of the word, then he must learn to be a fool before he really can be wise. Why? Because the wisdom of this world is foolishness to God. As the scripture says, the Lord knows wise men's thought. He knows how useless they are. Or again, God is not convinced by the arguments of the wise. So there is nothing to boast about in anything human. Paul, Apollos, Cephas, the word, the world, life and death, the present and the future, are all your servants. But you belong to Christ, and Christ belongs to God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us all stand for the gospel of the nation. You have learned how it was said, you must love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say this to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. In this way, you will be sons of your Father in heaven. For he causes his sun to rise on bad men as well as good, and his rain to fall on honest and dishonest men alike. For if you love those who love you, what right have you to claim and credit? Even the tax collectors do as much, do they not?
If you serve your greetings for your brothers, are you doing anything exceptional? Even the pagans do as much, do they not? You must therefore be perfect, just as your heavenly Father is perfect. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
My dear brothers and sisters, I would have loved to give you a homily as usual, but the Archbishop asked us to read to you today a pastoral letter, which I think is also part of the homily, because he captured the readings very well and he put his thoughts in it, and he's sending a message to us. This is the letter. Pastoral letter for the seventh day in ordinary time. 18th and 19th February 2023. On Wednesday, Lent begins. I write today to give you every possible encouragement to use these weeks of Lent to refresh and deepen your faith. As we have just heard from the book of Leviticus, be holy, for I, the Lord, your God, am holy. This is the heartfelt prayer. While there are so many challenges facing us all at this time, our faith underpins everything we do. The gift of faith gives our lives an enduring purpose and stability. A faith that is refreshed and deepened helps us to be gracious, steadfast, and even robust in every circumstance. I put before you today three ways of refreshing and renewing your faith. They are these: a renewed focus on Jesus, a fresh readiness to bear witness to Him, and thirdly, a conscious effort to build community and compassion wherever you may be. Let me speak about each one of them. First, during these weeks of Lent, please do all you can to place Jesus at the heart of your lives. Our relationship with Him is the foundation of all we strive for, our abiding strength, and our source of hope and joy. Without this relationship, our faith loses its heart and warmth, becoming a matter of outward observance rather than inner wonder. There can be no friendship with our blessed Lord unless we give Him space in our hearts. We need a time of prayer every day when we can simply talk to Him, bringing Him our worries and our joys. When and where you pray doesn't matter. Just whatever suits you. Pray in a style that appeals to you. Whatever that may be, but please do it. And encourage each other to do so, whether in family prayer or with friends, in each other's company, or even over Zoom.
Jesus is there, waiting to embrace you, to rejoice in your achievements, to comfort you in your trials. Please give him space in your day, every day. After all, St. Paul reminds us, you belong to Christ and Christ belongs to God. Now, the second aspect of the renewal, I hope you can find it, is this. Please, let this faith, this relationship with the Lord, express itself when you are with other people. I'm certainly not asking you to find a soapbox or in any way to force your faith onto others. No. But there are many moments when speaking of the goodness of the Lord is quite appropriate. For example, when someone is sharing with you their sorrow or distress, please don't hesitate to tell them you will pray for them. Or when you come across a person who is feeling alone or neglected, please do speak to them of the love of the Lord and the consolation you find in His presence. In the recent synodal discussions, many people expressed concern for those who feel excluded from the church, often because of their understanding of the church teaching. We must remember that the teaching of the church flows from words spoken by our blessed Lord to those striving to be close to Him. Yes, they are sometimes very demanding, but they are teachings which He gives us love, invitations which are life-giving. When we hear this voice speaking to our innermost heart, we can grasp the real meaning of those teachings. When we attend to His voice, we can hear it resonating with the voice of the church. Only with this attentiveness to Him can we truly explain to others the beauty of His teaching. When we fix our eyes on the Lord, feelings of exclusion can be overcome. We can appreciate more deeply that we are, each of us, made in the image and likeness of God. He has an embrace for everyone. He excludes no one. He offers an invitation to each person to come and follow Him. As we respond to that invitation, we become aware of a need for a change of heart and behavior. In one area of life or another, even though each of us make progress in His way, only gradually, step by step. The third thing I ask you of this land is to refresh in your lives the way you put faith into action. Here I want to highlight just one thing. In every circumstance, whether at home or school, at work or leisure, strive to be a bond of connection between persons. St. John Newman.
Building for others a sense of being accepted in a genuine first expression is a genuine first expression of the life that Jesus offers. When we recognize and respect the goodness in every person we meet and strive, however simply, to reach out to them, we put faith into practice. Can we echo in our actions just a little of that truth in today's sorrow, that the Lord is compassion and love? Building community, breaking down hostilities, is doing the work of our blessed Lord. It is a work so much needed in our troubled world. Every day we bring opportunities to do this. I hope that in the days of this Lent, each of us will make an extra effort to put our faith in the Lord into practice in this special way. This is the appeal of today's gospel message: a generous love that overcomes hostility. One of my favorite sayings is St. Francis of Assisi. There's a lovely story from maybe legend about him that I want to tell. It is said that towards the end of his life, when he was near to death, he gathered his followers together. Looking round, he said to them, "Brethren, let us begin to love the Lord, because so far we have made little progress." Well, if such a great saint can say those words, so can each of us. My appeal to you, then, is very simple. This Lent, try to make a little more progress in prayer, in speaking of our blessed Lord to others, and in being a bearer to others of his compassion and love. And please pray for me, as I will most certainly pray for you. Yours devotedly, Cardinal Vincent Nichols, Archbishop of Westminster. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Let us stand up and confess our faith.
Who has spoken to the prophets, I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess my baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
My dear brothers and sisters, as we now make our prayer for our community and for the world, especially the war in Russia, Ukraine, and DRC, let us pray to Christ the Lord for all our needs.
That Christ may lead the church in his way of love and forgiveness, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
That those who hold public office may serve their peoples with justice and integrity. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
That those who suffer from addictions may find strength and courage from God to overcome their problems. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
That we may have the graces we need to practice the virtue of temperance in our lives, choosing the path of moderation and restraint. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
That our brothers and sisters who are sick or sorrowful may receive healing and consolation from God and support from those around them. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
That the faithful departed who shared in Christ's suffering may also rise with him to new life in the kingdom where all tears are wiped away. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Let us the intercession of our dear Mother Mary as we pray.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death.
Amen. Heavenly Father, may we love you in all things, and all things, and hate you all to be perfect in love. We pray for peace, and we pray for peace in the other sea. For comfort and help in Turkey and in Syria. We make these and all our prayers in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and in the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Over all my pain.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that our sacrifice be accepted by the Lord.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice of your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good
and the good of all his holy church.
As we celebrate the mysteries, O Lord, with the observance that is your due, we humbly ask you that what we offer to the honor of your majesty may cope with us for salvation. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hands.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in you we live and move and have our being. And while in this world we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of the Spirit, through whom you raised up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in Paschal mystery. And so, with all the angels, we praise you as in joyful celebration we are praying. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. And once more, giving thanks, he gave the disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Mystery of faith. Blessed are those called
Beata.